Are revealing how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. I then cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. I did obey his blessed commands and gained the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He's bought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He's bought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Our hymn of invitation, Jesus is Calling, number 347.
We all shopped for cars and things like that, and we all like options, don't we? I like to keep my options open. Car shopping. I had a friend years ago that bought a new minivan, and he knew the salesman he was buying it from. Salesman called him and said, "Hey, we're putting free DVD players in this particular minivan. You should take it." He said, "Where was that 20 years ago when my kids were young and we were driving back and forth to Florida? I don't need it." He said, "Hey, it's $1,500, a $1,500 retail value. It's free. Take it." It's an option. Debbie and I had dinner the other night at a restaurant where salad bar was an option we could get with our meal if we wanted it. Excuse me. Well, what is an option? It's the act of choosing. It's the freedom to choose. And there are a lot of things in life that are options. Life is full of choices. When I roll out of bed in the morning, what am I going to wear today? I've got choices there I can make. What am I going to have for breakfast? What am I going to do for lunch? There's a lot of those kinds of options that we're going to have every day, but there are things in life that are not considered optional. I don't think the IRS is going to buy it if I tell them that I'm going to exercise the option to not pay my taxes. If the utility company, it is not optional that I pay my light bill or my rent. And if I value my reputation and my character and that sort of thing, of course, I'm going to make sure those bills get taken care of. I'm going to pay them because they're not optional. But too often we tend to view almost everything as an option. And that includes, it seems, obeying God these days. We can see that more and more in churches that are taking their worship services and turning them into entertainment. And they're looking at how we worship God. Well, that's optional. What about baptism? What about being immersed? Well, that's optional. Should I be immersed? Oh, no, that's an option. You can be poured or have water sprinkled on you. Some things are not options. If you remember the movie Apollo 13, I was just thinking about this while we were singing. I'd forgotten about it because it's been so long since I had seen it. But if you remember, there's a scene in there where they find out that the command module's got the fire or whatever it was that almost kept them in space. The mission control guy on the ground in Houston says, "We're going to bring them back. Failure is not an option." And there are times when you've got those situations where there are not options. What you've got is something that is actually required. And obedience to God is one of those things that is not an option. We cannot pick and choose whether or not we're going to obey God. But today we're going to look at someone who thought he could pick and choose. We're going to look today at the same guy we've been looking at the last few weeks, and that is Saul. You want to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 15. He thought obeying God was an option. And his attitude his obedience to God and how he looked at it is what eventually brought Saul down. And he realized it too late. But he couldn't do anything about it. By the time God decided that he was going to remove him from the throne, 1 Samuel chapter 15. And this is where God finally decides he's going to replace him as king. Now, let's look first at his disobedience. It wasn't anything that was just small. Look back at Samuel's edict. Look at verse 1 of 1 Samuel of chapter 15. Samuel said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people, over Israel. And now, therefore, heed the voice of words of the voice of the Lord." In other words, you need to listen to what God has to say. God made you king. And because of that, you are obliged to obey his commandment. This is a lesson I think our politicians today can learn. God has allowed you to be president or to be governor or mayor or whatever the office is. Therefore, you're obliged to obey God's commandments. Advance righteousness, not try and tear righteousness down like we've seen over the last several years. And that can be said of our politicians and our leaders today. If they are not godly, it will be to their downfall. Unfortunately, ungodly leaders end up dragging down the population too. That's a thing to look at with a person in leadership. People in leadership, their decisions definitely affect others. Whether it's, say, the husband with a wife and a couple of kids, his decision can affect the wife and kids. The mayor of this little town we live in, decisions he makes or the council makes can affect all of us. So always remember that. We have been saved by grace. And Saul had been given God's grace. You have been saved by grace through faith, that not of yourself. And he had been forgiven. He had, because of God's grace, just like us, he had been put into power. Paul later on would tell the Corinthians, "Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? You are not," watch this, "you are not your own. For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." You see, Paul's conclusion is pretty simple. God has a right to expect obedience. He paid the price for our salvation. So he expects obedience. He has a right to do that. If you give a party and you hire the band to play the music, guess who gets to pick the playlist? And if you are paying that caterer, guess who gets to pick the menu? You do. God has paid for our salvation. Guess who gets to expect obedience? Yeah, God. Guess who gets to make the rules for what constitutes proper Christian life? Yeah, God, not me. Not a church council somewhere. Look at verses 2 and 3. God's command to Saul, you see, is very clear. "I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel, how he ambushed him on his way out of Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have. Do not spare them. Kill both man and woman, infant, nursing child, ox, camel, sheep, and donkey." This goes back to Exodus. When they were coming out of Egypt, headed for the promised land, they're actually distantly related, Israel and Amalek. Amalek's a grandson of Esau. And you know, I'm not a genealogist. I don't know how many cousins, so many times removed. But when Israel came out of Egypt, it was the Amalekites who made an attack on them. And God's now decided he's going to take care of that. It was that act that prompted God to say that Israel would always be at war with Amalek. And so a common misconception of our society today, and Amalek probably thought this because it had been so long now since they made that attack coming out of Egypt. It had been hundreds of years. Here's a common misconception. We can get away with our sin. Now stop and think for a minute. Maybe you did something when you were a kid. Maybe you took a little money out of dad's wallet or fibbed a little bit about how late you stayed out. And you think, "Hey, I got away with it." Well, maybe as far as dad or mom is concerned, but God's word says different. Numbers 32 says, "Be sure your sin will find you out." Ecclesiastes, "Because sins against An evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart and sons of men is fully set in them to do evil. It shall not be well with the wicked, neither shall he prolong his days, which are as a shadow, because he does not fear God. Yeah, there's a lot of crimes. If we go down here to the Hansville Police Department, we go to the FBI, we're going to find volumes and volumes and volumes of crimes that have never been solved. Some of them are just little petty thefts, some of them are murder that have never officially been solved, but we may not know who did it, but I guarantee you that God knows who did it. God knows who's responsible for the Lindbergh kidnapping. You remember the John Benet Ramsey case out in Colorado? God knows who did that. Officially, none of these are ever solved. But they will eventually be caught. That's what Saul didn't get. Then eventually he was going to have to pay the price that his sin would catch up to him. And I think a lot of people, your sins are going to catch up to you in this lifetime. It's just a few that maybe get away from it. His error was, look at verses 4 through 7. He only obeyed God to a point. He killed off most of the Amalekites, but he kept some for himself. Let's look at verses 4 through 7. Saul gathered the people together and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 foot soldiers and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came to a city of Amalekites and lay in wait in the valley. Then Saul said to the Kenites, "Go depart, get down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them. For you showed kindness to all the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt." So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites, and Saul attacked the Amalekites from Havilah all the way to Shur, which is in east of Egypt. And he also took King Agag, of the king of the Amalekites alive and utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep. Now remember, what was God's instructions? Kill them all off. He obeyed God to a point. He had obeyed God pretty well, actually, up to this point. Saul even showed mercy to these Kenites. How many of us will show obedience to God to a point? How many people in the religious world will show obedience to God to a point? That's what happened here. Look at verse 8. You see his obedience, verses 8 to 9, is only partial. Saul only obeyed God's command to the point that made sense to him. And this is where we typically fumble the ball. Well, it doesn't make sense for me for God to do X, so I don't think he does that. It doesn't make sense to me for God to send people into hell for eternity, so I don't believe he's going to do that. Well, that doesn't make sense to you either. It doesn't matter that it makes sense to you. What matters is that God said it. How many of us, when we were kids, our parents wanted us to do something? Why? I don't understand. It doesn't make any sense. I'm the dad. Do it. I'm your mother. Do it. And how many of us have said that to our own kids? It may not make sense. There's stuff, yeah, the dad or mom wanted me that didn't make sense. Some of it I still don't understand. But some of it, looking back, I can get it. Okay, now, yeah, I get it. I look back as an adult and I understand it. And that's exactly what Saul did here. He was just looking for the things he could understand. And, you know, even though I preach and studied the Bible for years, there's still a lot I don't understand. You know, people have asked, well, why did God pick baptism? I really don't know. You know, to me, I would have done something a whole lot more sensible. You need to go down to Olive Garden and have lasagna. To me, that would make a whole lot more sense. But God didn't ask me. Saul then assumed God wouldn't mind if he spared Agag. Doesn't this sound familiar? God's not going to care if I fill in the blank. I go play golf instead of worship with his people. God's not going to care about that. God's not going to care that I don't go to church, that I haven't become a Christian. It's easy to get to that point where we just try to vindicate ourselves or vindicate Saul. He did almost everything God told him to do. But partial obedience, remember, is just disobedience. Saul never completed the task God gave him to do. When you told your kids to go out mowing the lawn and rake the grass up, they just mowed the lawn. They've obeyed you to a point. So you're going to pay them for doing that job or let them go to the movies tonight or whatever the deal was? Well, no, you didn't do the whole job. Saul didn't do the whole job here either. And then we have to look at his denial. He never completed what God wanted to do, just killed certain of the Amalekites and Agag. Then look at verse 10, how God lets it be known he's not happy. The word of the Lord came to Samuel, saying, I greatly regret that I have set up Saul as king, for he has turned back from following me, and has not performed my commandments. And it grieved Samuel that he cried out to the Lord all night long. Now, this is a tricky verse when you look at God's displeasure here. Now, I think the old King James says, it repenteth me. I think that's what it says. Most newer ones say, I regret, or I deeply regret. And we think, now remember, this is Hebrew. We speak English. Our words don't mean the same all the time, don't always mean the same thing as what that Hebrew word of from thousands of years ago means. Our English words don't always mean the same thing that the Greek word means. And so the term regret or repent can be a little misleading. But here again, the English translators didn't ask me how to translate this. This is just what we have to go with. It implies some sort of imperfection. How many of us can look back on a decision and say, boy, I regret doing that? I regret buying that car. How many of you who owned a house or two can look back and say, boy, I regret buying that first house? Yeah. You know, it was a mistake. You shouldn't have done it. And we can take in English and look at this and say, well, God made a mistake. But that's not what it is. Samuel later in the chapter says God does not repent like a man. So how are we going to put this all together? Well, here's how I think it goes together. God does change direction sometimes. Saul was king of Israel. Saul changed. God didn't change. Saul changed. He did not follow the path that God had laid out for him. God would have continued to deal with Saul mercifully and would have continued to extend grace to him. But what was happening here was he finally reached a point where God said, okay, I've had enough. Like we might do with someone maybe that we are like an employer. You've got someone you've been working with them for days, weeks, months. It's just not working out. Eventually, you've got to call them in and say, hey, this isn't working. I've got to let you go. You're not getting down the procedures. You've got an attitude issue, whatever it is. That's basically what happened here. Saul has changed. You think of God as the employer and Saul as the employee. He's not doing the job that I need him to do. He's got obviously some attitude problems with my instructions. I've got to let him go. And that's what happened. It was his disobedience that got him into trouble. So God said, I'm going to go in a different direction. And that's what happened. Look at verses 13 to 15, reproving the disobedience. Notice when Saul comes along, or rather Samuel, I mean, comes along and reproves. But Samuel rose early in the morning to meet Saul, and it was told Samuel, saying, Saul went to Carmel, and indeed he set up a monument for himself. Wow. I can think of some other people in the Bible that have done that, and in modern times that have done that. Let's see, he's gone on around and passed by and gone on down to Gilgal. Samuel went to Saul and said to him, blessed are you of the Lord, I have performed the commandment of the Lord. But Samuel said, what then is this bleating of sheep in my ears and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? Saul said, they have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared. Notice he's saying the people spared the best of the sheep and the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed. So notice his blatant disobedience. He's really denying any wrongdoing. Notice the people spared. I didn't have anything to do with that. They did. Remember Harry Truman had a sign on his desk. What did it say? The buck stops here. Ultimately, he was responsible for what his administration did. Saul is missing that. He needs a sign that says the shekel stops here. Because ultimately, he's the leader. He's the king. He's ultimately responsible for what the people do. And notice he didn't even try to stop them with what they were doing. This reminds me of a story I read about the Indy 500. I didn't get the year that this happened, but Scott Goodyear was starting in the race that year. And he said, when there's an accident, you don't watch the film on television. You don't deal with it. You pretend it never happened. The Speedway operation itself encourages this approach. As soon as the track closes the day of an accident, a crew heads out to paint over the spot where the car hit the wall. Through the years, a driver has A driver has never been pronounced dead on the track of the Indy 500. A trip to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway Racing Museum, located inside the 2.5 mile oval track, has no memorial to the 40 drivers who have lost their lives there. Nowhere are they even mentioned. And I've been to that museum a couple of times, and I didn't even notice until I read this that there is no memorial there for the drivers who were killed there. Now, does that negate the fact that there have been drivers who've lost their lives there because they're ignoring it? No. And you can see the same thing in a football game. If a player gets hurt, he's seriously hurt. And you can see the other players are kneeling down, with holding hands, they're praying. The coaches are standing there with their war face on, walking around. The trainers are out there. And here they bring up that golf cart or whatever it is, and they pick them up and carry them off. And the announcers will say, yeah, they're taking them off. They're going to take them down to the hospital. And our thoughts and prayers are with them. Then what happens? They resume play. You know, the offense comes out, the defense comes out. The coach is deciding what plays to call, and you might hear from the announcer that, they've x-rayed his neck, and they thought it might be broken, but it's just a sprain. It's not as bad as we thought, but they're not thinking about it out there. They're ignoring it as if it didn't happen. If I ignore my sin, does that mean it goes away? It's still there. If a driver in the Indy 500 hits the wall and is killed, does their ignoring it make it go away? Or does ignoring an injury to a football player make it go away? No. It's still there. And in this case, Saul, you notice, thinks he's performed, look at verse 13, the commandments of the Lord. Then he admits he has not obeyed God. And then in verse 21, he's pointing out, this, or rather Samuel then points out, that God prefers obedience. To obey is better than the sacrifice. And that's what we have to remember too. It's better to obey God than go off and do what we think has to be done. Because just because it doesn't make any sense to us, doesn't mean God's going to buy that excuse. A couple of ideas to deal with here. One is, we've kind of looked at it, is I'll do evil that good may come of it. Doing evil. And this is where I think the idea behind abortion comes from. Because it is killing an unborn life. Medically, scientifically, there's no way you can get around that. But because this teenager or this 20-something has got an unwanted pregnancy, rather than have her carry it and put the baby up for adoption or other options, we'll just go ahead and kill it. We will do evil so that good could come out. But what's the great line? There's no right way to do a wrong thing. And that's what happens here with our society. Someone once likened the idea of when Bud Light sells beer on certain dates and then donates a portion of the proceeds to Special Olympics. Hey, they're doing a really good thing. Yeah, but what product do you have to buy to do that? I'd rather just give my money straight to Special Olympics or whatever the cause is. And then we also have the idea that if I do good in one area of my life, God will overlook the evil in another area of my life. This probably, in my mind, the best way to illustrate this is the old mafia crime bosses on the East Coast, or the drug cartel leaders in Central and South America. I'm out here killing people, running drugs, doing this and doing that, but I'm giving $1,000 a week to the Catholic parish or the church down here. So God is going to overlook that. You know, I'm going to get all my indulgences or whatever, or he's going to overlook my sin because of all the money I'm giving. Or because, and it doesn't work that way. Just doing good in one area of your life, you may cure cancer. But if you still have sin in your life, it's not going to do any good standing before God. And then we see Saul's downfall. God finally had enough. Look at verses 23 and 28. Disobedience brings about his disgrace. And notice how God looks at self-will and rebellion. God doesn't put up with it. Notice Saul built a statue to himself. We're told here, then if you look at verse 23, rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and the stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he has also rejected you from being king. That's pretty strong. Disobeying God is on par with witchcraft. You see, it brought about his own downfall. Saul had nobody to blame but himself. He wanted to blame the people. Hey, the people, they didn't kill off Agag and all the Amalekites like they were supposed to. It's not blame them. Back at Sinai, Moses comes down. Aaron, why did you build this? Hey, the people made me do it. Hey, Flip Wilson, remember him? Oh, the devil made me do it. We like to do that and rationalize so that we don't have to take responsibility for our own sins. And then when you go into 2 Samuel, you'll see how Saul's disobedience eventually cost him his life. So there's a meme that I see every once in a while on Facebook that says, if at first you fail, do it the way mom said to do it. Well, if at first you fail, do it the way God said to do it. If you can. Saul didn't have a chance here. He was eventually killed and was no longer able to do the way that the Lord wanted him to. Sin is serious. Obedience to God is not an option. And I'm not talking about just the plan of salvation and being baptized. But what about the rest of the week when you come out of the baptistry? How are you living your life when you're away from here? In humble obedience to God? Or is it just, I'm living the way I want to live? I don't know how most people live their lives the way I see some of you when I'm out and about, maybe talk to you on the phone. But you know how you're living. So are you living like Saul in rebellion, in denial, or are you living the way God wants you to live? We can help you to stay on the path or get back on it, whichever is appropriate. Let us know. We'd like to pray with you and help to encourage you as best we can. Let us know as we stand and as we sing.
Jesus is calling, calling, calling. Jesus is calling today. Why should I linger, linger, linger? I will arise and away. They are so happy, 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 who to their Savior obey. Why should I linger, linger, linger? I will arise and away. Jesus is pleading, pleading, pleading. Why should I wander in sin? While to his glory, 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 when he would welcome me in. They are so happy, 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 who to their Savior obey. Why should I linger, linger, linger? I will arise and away. Jesus is waiting, waiting, waiting. Open now, stand at the door. Soon the night falleth, 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 closer the gates evermore. They are so happy, 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 who their Savior obey. Why should I linger, linger, linger? I will arise and go.
Please be seated. If there are those present this afternoon who have not had the opportunity to take the Lord's Supper, if you'll come as we sing the first verse of I gave my life for